Hey, nubbiecakes here, and today I'm going to talk about a CD key reselling site known as G2A, which I believe stands for either Games to All or Games to Auction, but that's kind of irrelevant. And if you're one of my loyal subscribers, you may have seen this video posted once before. I'll explain why that video was short-lived, but if you don't care to hear the explanation, click the annotation to skip it. But I did this video once before, and I made a number of misspeaks where I just said incorrect information due to a lack of research on my own part. And also, I posted it to Reddit at the time in the gaming subreddit, and I was met with some, let's just call it resistance, in the form of a particular user who was adamantly against G2A, and although I don't agree with some of the things he said, it did bring to light some stuff that I hadn't considered about the business structure of G2A and how it affects the video game industry in general and how games are sold and priced and all that. But I'll get into that more as I go on with the review. So the first thing I want to talk about is an article written by Polygon, who studied how the games are actually acquired by the sellers who use G2A, and I believe they were also talking about a website called Kingwin, who does basically the same thing, but this is mainly going to be talking about G2A this video. I don't know enough about other websites, and I don't want to misspeak again about them, so this is specifically about G2A. Now, I'm going to link this article in the description if you'd like to read the whole thing, but I'll kind of summarize it for you, and all the sources I used, I'll try to make sure to put in the description just so you can see, you know, what it was before my interpretation was put on it, but I'll try to keep this as fair as I can, although I will admit I really like G2A, so I may be a little biased towards it, but like I said, I'm going to try to stay fair, and I'll give the reasons why I'm in favor of it, you know, towards the end of the video after some stuff has been discussed. But anyways, Polygon did this whole article talking about how games were acquired to be sold on G2A, and it's actually a pretty interesting read if you want to look through it. It's a long read also, but mainly, they studied a particular game and tried to trace it back to the person who bought it, and they found that it had passed through four different hands, and eventually the original owner of the game couldn't be tracked down, or refused to speak where they got it from. It was pretty shady. But one of the games in particular they talk about is Gravity Ghost. And this particular game was sold as a two-pack. You buy one and you get one for free. There was no option, as far as I know, to only buy a single copy. Now, that's a really cool thing for the dev to do. You know, you can get the game, give a copy to your friend so you can both play it and enjoy it. However, I'm of the mindset that that's an unnecessary nicety. In my mind, you could just price the game for half as much, and then you wouldn't have to worry about what's happening to the second copy. Although, obviously, the intention is, you know, a good one from the developer, so can't really fault them for it, but at the same time, it was an unrequested, not necessarily undesired, but a game that somebody didn't really have an option to get. And that's where I was under the impression a lot of these games came from, is say you buy a new NVIDIA graphics card, and a lot of the times they'll package it with like two of the new AAA titles, like, I don't know, let's just say Metal Gear Solid and The Witcher 3 or something. So say you buy a new graphics card, you already had these games, say you got the graphics card just to be able to play the games more smoothly. But now you're stuck with these two games which are worth, you know, maybe $40 to $60 retail, but you have nothing to do with them. Sure, you could give them to a friend, but a lot of the time, I think people just end up forgetting about it or putting it on a website like G2A, where people really are reselling. It's almost like eBay. somebody gets the key, they sell it through G2A. G2A is just the intermediate that facilitates the transaction. Now, obviously, there is a lot of room for abuse. And another thing this Polygon article talks about is how early review codes are given out by developers. Just by emailing a developer saying, hey, you know, I'm a big YouTuber and I'd like to review your game and give it some publicity. Would you mind sending me a code for free? Again, I don't see how this is the fault of anyone except the person who gives out the code. Well, to rephrase that, I don't see how a code being given out for free to somebody who they think is a reviewer is really any different than giving it to someone who resells it. Obviously, they're expecting the reviewer to kind of boost their sales with some publicity, but at the same time, if they're not doing their due diligence to check if this YouTuber is actually a legitimate existence on YouTube, then that's kind of their own fault in my book. Now, again, I don't want to sound like I'm saying people shouldn't do these things, but there are checks that they could do, like a simple search for the YouTube name and a cross-check with the email address. Like, I wouldn't expect anyone to give me a code for free with 50 subscribers on YouTube. You know, that's just not... It's not the publicity they get is nowhere near the price of the game, even. So, you know, that's a very, very simplified version of what the Polygon story says. And another thing that's important to mention that they talk about was the big fiasco with The Witcher 3. And if you remember when The Witcher 3 came out, there were a very large number of codes that were bought with a credit card, which, and this is kind of ambiguous, it was either a stolen credit card or a card that was claimed to be stolen and the charge was refunded by whoever used the credit card, which is called a chargeback most of the time. And then the retailer revoked all those keys if they hadn't already been activated and said, you know, we weren't paid for these, but, you know, so you can't use them. Now, this left the people who bought them in a really tough situation because they did pay for the game. It was the person they bought it from who hadn't paid, and G2A hadn't really done anything other than facilitate the transaction, so they, as far as I know, couldn't really refund the money because it was already in the hands of the seller. So that was a very, very big situation. There were tens of thousands of keys that ended up being revoked, and like I said, if they hadn't already been activated, they were just unusable by the person who bought them. So a lot of people got a really bad taste in their mouth from CD key reselling sites. And also, I believe Project Red came out and said, you know, only buy our keys from authorized retailers. And that's fine. That's honestly, that's probably the one thing I can say that the buying it from an official authorized retailer will do is you're guaranteed that key will work. Now, in all my experience on G2A, and I've bought a lot of games on G2A, I haven't once had a bad CD code, and they also started offering this thing called G2A Shield, which guarantees the CD code to be usable, and if it isn't, they'll refund your money. Now, that's also something I've seen a lot of misinformation go out about G2A. I saw someone claim on Reddit, a post that got a lot of upvotes and attention. They claimed that they got signed up for the G2A Shield subscription inadvertently when they bought a single game. I personally don't see how that could happen unless you're just not paying attention to what you're doing. And if you're using a CD or a credit card number on the internet and not paying attention to where you're putting it, what checkboxes you're checking and all that before you hit checkout, that's your own fault. That's not G2A's fault. But I'm assuming G2A maybe defaulted to the subscription, because you can also buy the Shield on just a single purchase, or you can pay for it monthly, and it's basically the price you would pay when you get a single game. You can pay monthly and, you know, have it for every game you buy for each month. I still have it. It's like $1.30 each month, which, who cares? It's $1.30, and I buy frequently enough that it's worth it to me. So maybe that's a testament to how much I buy on there. But I've just seen too much misinformation about G2A come out, and I saw one again today where someone was claiming that most, if not all, of the G2A keys being sold on the website are stolen. He just said they're blatantly stolen, and they're the worst thing to ever happen to the games industry. That is completely incorrect. I have never seen evidence to suggest that. There may be stolen keys, and more than likely there are stolen keys, but you kind of have to be clear about your definition of stolen. If you mean, you know, somebody got one of those codes from the developer for free, and you're going to consider that stolen, I guess you could call that stolen. The only thing I would say that's actually stolen is if somebody buys a key with a credit card and then gets the charge back. That's a legitimate stolen key in my book. Otherwise, I think it's, again, in the gray area, which is why this is called the gray market. And also, it's called the gray market because if you look closely at the fine print of those games when you get them in promotions, they usually say not for resale or something to that effect, and they don't expect you, or I know they don't want you, to come turn around and resell it. But you know, I'm 25, I'm from the days where, or sorry, I'm not that old, but I remember when I was a kid, when I was gaming, almost every game had to have the physical CD key, or the physical CD with an associated key. However, once you were done with the game, you beat it, or if you just wanted to let a friend borrow it, you could do that. And he could play the game no problem as long as you both weren't like trying to access online at the same time, because that's really the only time it would check the CD key. And also, during that time, you had to have the CD to play the game, so it's not like I could lend it to him and still play it unless you make an ISO, but that's a whole different story, and that was frowned upon too. So my point is, it's not like reselling games is a new thing. It's just the fact that all games are digital now that it's become this, you know, nebulous, frowned upon thing. And I've seen people say that they would buy the game from G2A instead of pirating. And I've seen people actually argue that it's better to pirate because then the person selling it on G2A and G2A themselves don't make any money on it. And I just think that's ridiculous. Because there's a lot to games. They log concurrent players and all that type of stuff, especially the first few days it comes out, can really help those figures can help the perceived success of the game. Where if you have a pirated copy, none of those numbers are ever going to show up because you're never really on the game. You're kind of off the grid, or however you want to put it. So I will never say that it's better to pirate a game than anything. If you're pirating a game, I've never pirated a game. I don't think it's okay, to be honest. You know, especially with G2A now, and I have to say, G2A didn't just spring out of nowhere. It wasn't like somebody was sitting on a pile of stolen CD keys and was just like, oh, let me make a website so I can sell all these. G2A came out of necessity, which is what capitalism, the free market, does. Where there's a need, someone will fill it. And that's what G2A did. They saw all these people with CD keys that they don't want, so they, you know, became a facilitator for selling it. Now, another way that these CD keys are obtained that I didn't touch on before, which I believe is also mentioned in the Polygon article, is that sometimes games are sold at a lower price in other regions of the world. And this is something that was also brought up in the Reddit conversation I mentioned in the intro, that I hadn't really thought about before, and that's, if you've noticed, a lot of games now have regional locks. That's because of places like G2A, where people will, a big one is Russia. I guess the yearly average income is a lot lower there, so a AAA game that might be $60 in the US would be $40 equivalent in Russia. So someone will buy, you know, however many they can in Russia, and then sell it on G2A, and it won't be any cheaper than the price it is in Russia, but it'll be drastically cheaper than it is in America. So they could buy a bunch for 40, resell them for 45, somebody buys it at a 15% discount, and the seller's still making $5. And in my book, the developer's still making money. They sold it for that price, so I don't really see how it's that bad. However, the conversation I had said that, you know, this will basically kill the market in these smaller countries where they can't afford to buy the games at like a U.S. retail price. And I don't know if this is insensitive, but I'm sorry if you're that torn over an additional $20 equivalent, then maybe you shouldn't be focusing on video games. And he in specific sounded like he travels a lot. He said that it causes issues for him when he needs to travel out of the country, and then he can't play a game because it's region locked to one place, and then he goes overseas and, you know, can't play it anymore. And, you know, my answer to his problem was basically that's what regional locks are for, but of course that wouldn't satisfy him since his problem is that he wants to go outside of his region and still be able to play the game. I think that's an extremely small amount of the gaming population that would face that problem, and I don't know what you would do to fix that. But since my first video, there was also a story by tinybuild that came out where they basically accused G2A of costing them $450,000 in video game sales. And this actually brought up some more interesting information about, you know, the relationship between G2A and some of the developers. If you're unfamiliar with tinybuild, they are an indie game company who have made titles such as Cluster Truck, Speedrunners, One Troll Army, Punch Club, a handful of others. And on that note, I will have to say G2A, it seems like, would be particularly damaging for indie developers. I will definitely concede that, because indie titles are usually priced pretty low, and obviously the companies making them are a whole lot smaller. They can't really afford to lose that much money on every sale. Whereas, you know, a company like EA or maybe, I don't know, Ubisoft, you know, the big, you know, ugly, evil faces in the gaming industry, I think most of us would be okay if they missed out on $20 for a new game that, you know, ends up being disappointing, cough, cough, The Division, cough. And on that note, there's also something I want to talk about with a game called Battleborn. Battleborn was something I got off G2A for, I believe, $46 pre-release, where, of course, it was $60 on Steam. Well, within a matter of 3 weeks, the game was being sold for $40. Now, if I bought that game for $60 and saw the price drop that drastically within a matter of weeks, I would be furious. And I don't think it's okay that that happens without, you know, maybe a partial refund to the people who pre-ordered and bought earlier. It's stuff like that that really makes me feel little remorse, you know, buying a game cheaper on G2A. Now, that's not going to be the case for a lot of games, but just for another, you know, contemporary example, No Man's Sky. Massive disappointment. But that also brings up another protection you don't have when buying from G2A that you do have when buying from somewhere like Steam. Say you buy a game on G2A, it just flat out doesn't work. Let's use Batman Arkham Knight, for example. Just horrible lagging, horrible crashing, just unplayable mess. Or, you know, again, No Man's Sky, where it's just not what you were expecting, you're not satisfied. Steam has a very forgiving refund policy, the 2 weeks, 2 hours played policy, where if for any reason you don't want to keep the game after 2 hours played within a 2 week time frame, you can refund it. And I think that's pretty awesome, but again, you're paying the full retail price, and you know, you're getting that protection, whereas on G2A you can pay less, but you're not going to have that. Another method I forgot to mention on how these CD keys are obtained are promotional sales. And let's say websites like Humble Bundle or Bundle Stars, where they'll bundle a bunch of games together, sell it really cheap. And a lot of times you may only want one of the games from the bundle, so then you're still stuck with all these CD CD codes for... Sorry, there's no CD in the situation here, so activation codes that you don't want, you can't use, you know, maybe a friend might want it, I don't know, but it's just useless keys. And on Humble Bundle, they actually specifically say that the keys you buy are only meant for you. But at the last time I checked, when you buy something, especially in the US, it's your property. I don't know why that would be different for an electronic, you know, game or any other electronic property, but I don't see why when I buy something, I don't have the right to do whatever I want with it. That's, you know, the definition of ownership means I can do whatever I want with it. I can delete it, I can copy it, I can paste it. I can't copy and resell it. But if I, you know, if I buy it and resell it, I don't see why that's a problem. Obviously, I can see the problem in copying and reselling, but, you know, as long as there's the same number of keys in existence as there were given out by the actual developer, I don't really see what the issue is. And I don't think somebody can tell me how I'm allowed to use something after I've paid for it. Now, back to the tinybuild article. They talk about how, you know, they break down how the prices, the disparity between the pricing on G2A versus retail pricing. Now, if you look at their math, it shows G2A pricing, total sales, and looks like they're assuming every game was bought one way or the other. So they're saying all these copies were bought, you know, either retail or G2A, which, you know, is a ridiculous thing to say. And they're also counting all three of their games, and they're saying they sold on G2A for just under 200,000, where it would have sold for just over 450,000 through retail pricing. So the reply that tinybuild got when they presented G2A with these numbers was, "The issue you've pointed to is related to the keys you have already sold. They are your partners that have sold the keys on G2A, which they purchased directly from you. If anything, this should give you an idea of the reach G2A has. Instead of your partners selling here, you could do that directly. I can tell you that no compensation will be given. If you suspect these were all chargebacks, aka fraud, stolen credit card purchases, I would be happy to look into that. However, I would say this requires tinybuild to want to work with G2A. Both in that you need to revoke the keys you will be claiming as stolen from the players who now own them, and supply myself with the codes you suspect of being a part of this. We will check to see if this is the case, but I doubt the codes with such large numbers would be that way. Honestly, I think you'd be surprised that it is not fraud, but your resale partners doing what they do best, selling keys. They just happen to be selling them on G2A. It is also worth pointing out that we do not take a share in these prices. Our part comes from the kickback our payment From the kickback our payment providers. I don't know what that means, but I guess from some sort of transaction fee. So basically, tinybuild summarizes it saying that G2A claims our distribution partners are scamming us and simply selling keys on G2A. They won't help us unless we are willing to work with them. We are not going to get compensated, and they expect us to undercut our own retail partners and Steam to compete with the unauthorized resellers. There's no real way to know which keys were leaked or not, and deactivating a full batch of keys would make a ton of fans angry, be it keys bought officially or not." Now, I don't know how true that is. Maybe it's different for an indie developer, but it seems like it was possible for The Witcher 3 to be done only to those keys which were bought unrightfully. So there were a number of updates here. They told G2A that they had a time frame to respond. Now, G2A did respond, and they actually published this PDF statement, kind of clearing the air on a few things, saying how they got keys and all that stuff. In particular, in reference to tinybuild, in reference to the $450,000 potentially lost for tinybuild. Why did tinybuild refer only to the highest price point in their product history? While on the real market, you can buy their products in a bundle for on an 85% off discount as sourced from Steam database. Finding a better medium price here would give a true overview. Tinybuild should explain the media why they omitted their sales data from revenue projection. This is the point I already discussed. Games are bought during sales prices, so it's really disingenuous for Tinybuild to say, oh, well, we lost this much when they have been offering games at sale prices. Now, tell me, what is the difference between a single person buying, screw it, let's say 5,000 keys at a sale price and 5,000 people buying 5,000 keys at a sale price? It's just when those keys are used. And, you know, maybe the person who bought them and resells them on G2A will hike the price a little bit to get their share out of it. But they're also allowing people who maybe didn't know about the game at the time of the sale or didn't want to pay what the full price was and didn't notice it was on sale, or, you know, what have you. They just may not have even bought the game until it had gotten to that sale price again, or waited until the sale price, whatever the process is. I fail to see how it's different. It's almost like a cosigner, or a consignment shop, like a pawn shop. The way I see it, the company is getting the money sooner than later, which is usually the point of a sale in the first place. So if the company is still getting the money, the only difference being how many of the keys are being used and how quickly they're being used, I really don't think that's a strong enough point to argue. Honestly, it's smart business. Either retailers need to limit the amount of the codes they'll sell at a sale price. There's no reason to allow someone to buy over maybe four, I guess. Even four, I don't understand when people sell four packs for a game. I have friends, but they have their own money. They're going to buy the game if they want it. Like, maybe just because I'm forever alone and I don't have that many friends that I've never bought games for three other people when I buy a game, but to me, they could just offer the games for a lower price or come to the realization that, yeah, if we're putting these games on sale, what's the difference between them being bought from G2A at slightly above the sale price rather than being bought, you know, at the next sale or by the same people during that initial sale? There isn't a difference, not enough to be argued. G2A also said that they were going to change the process in which they validate vendors on their site. And I actually contacted both G2A and Tinybuild during this whole process. I was trying to get some information about, you know, how each of them felt. Now, I don't believe I can actually show the emails since I didn't ask permission. Basically, all I got out of it was asking G2A, you know, what their stance on the whole matter was, and this was while it was still developing. And also I asked Tinybuild if they were satisfied with the ultimate conclusion. If you look at update 6 on the Tinybuild article, you can see they are going to start a program where royalties will be paid to developers and a database, or access to the database for developers, I guess, to verify the keys. Now, Tinybuild says, you know, this is a step in the right direction, but we're going to have to see how it goes. And when I asked the contact I was speaking to, he said, you know, basically the same thing. It's a step in the right direction, but it wasn't fully satisfactory. And the G2A representative basically told me before this was out, you know, we're going to have a statement, and then this ended up being it. And he said, you know, they weren't sure what else they could do, but at the same time, you can't really accuse something of being, you know, poor business methods or ethics or whatever without really offering a better alternative. And maybe you're of the stance that there is no better alternative. A site like G2A just should not exist. I am not of that stance. Like I said before, I have used G2A quite a lot, and I was also accused of being sponsored by G2A and, you know, a shill, if that word even has any meaning anymore. But I can assure you, at 50 subscribers, nobody's trying to sponsor me. G2A does have a system where you can create your own referral link, where if people buy games from G2A using your link, you'll get a certain percentage that you can then use to buy games on their website, which I do have and had linked at the bottom of some of my videos, which may have spurred the accusation. However, I think that's a pretty cool thing, personally. And I don't really see what the problem with that is. That's called marketing and promotion. That's what most companies do. If you look at G Fuel, practically every freaking YouTuber now has a G Fuel code. I don't see what the big deal is. I don't think it's the end of the gaming market. I think it brings to light some of the problems that have been persistent for a long time, ever since gaming has shifted to a digital medium rather than a physical CD, which some people may still think games were digital, but you still had to have that CD and the CD key with it. I don't think it's nearly as big of a problem. I don't think it's the end of the gaming industry as we know it. G2A is a sponsor for a lot of professional esports teams, which it was brought up to me that they were banned from the League of Legends tournaments. But that is not because League of Legends disagrees with their general business practices. It's because there were accounts with leveled up, you know, ELO. They were like diamond rank accounts that were being sold on G2A. So basically people were able to buy accounts that already had, you know, undue experience. And that obviously is not okay. Like, and G2A doesn't allow that anymore. Once they were told about it, they stopped it. But, you know, they're still not allowed at League of Legends tournaments. So if you've ever noticed, that's why G2A is never sponsoring a League of Legends team. But you may notice that there are a lot of YouTubers and a lot of other professional gamers who are sponsored by G2A. And you know what? More power to them. There are plenty of people who say that it's the worst thing ever. Even Total Biscuit, a guy who I really respect, I think he's a really intelligent man, he says, you know, it's basically just a fence for reselling stolen keys. So is a pawn shop. So is eBay. But it's also a way for legitimate people to sell legitimate things. And I guess maybe some people don't. I've never been really to a pawn shop myself, but they have a place. And I think G2A has a place. And I don't disagree that maybe they could validate and try to kind of verify the way keys are bought and sold a little bit more, but at the same time that also kind of eliminates a lot of the convenience of it. And you know, obviously you don't want to make it so hard that it keeps anyone but the professional resellers from doing it. They want to make sure normal people like you and me can go on and resell a game if we don't want it for whatever reason. So you know, I'd like to know your opinion on it. Do you think it's the worst thing ever? Did I maybe open your eyes to a different side of it that you hadn't thought about? Do you have any ideas on maybe how they could improve the process by which they verify the vendors they facilitate? Or do you think there's no problem with it? I think they could do with a little bit better verification, but in large, I think it fills a need, and I am very grateful for it. So, catch you next time.